Greetings and welcome to the lecture notes for the chemical reactions chapter, which I call Chapter 4, Part 1. Chapter 4, Part 1 is going to focus on the chemical reaction, which is kind of like a sentence in chemistry. And through a chemical reaction, a chemist learns how to make things, which is basically in part how chemists get paid. Now, if you're going to make something, though, you have to know the ingredients, and we'll talk about how cooking and chemistry are kind of similar in this chapter. So we'll talk about the reactants, which are like the ingredients, if you will, in a recipe. And we'll talk about the product, the kind of the thing or things you're going to get out of the reaction, similar to what you're trying to make in the recipe. So it's kind of a cool chapter. This is a powerful chapter for chemistry. And without further ado, let's get into it. Earlier, I mentioned how chemistry is kind of like cooking, and a chemical reaction is similar to like a recipe if you're in the kitchen, all right? And if you have cooked anything before, you know that it's really important to have good ingredients, like quality ingredients and stuff that makes for a better thing. Also, the correct amounts are important. So like down there on the bottom, you can see there's like some chocolate and flour and sugar and eggs and stuff, and they're making a cake, all right? And that's similar to a chemical reaction where A and B come together to make some new compound. Let's call them AB. But if you have too much of one, then sometimes things get crazy, or if you don't have enough of one, it can be bad. Now, unlike in a regular kitchen where if you don't add enough flour, your cake might not be good or something like that, in a chemical reaction, you can have real hazardous conditions if you don't pay attention to these things. So it's kind of important. So you can see in the upper right-hand corner there was definitely a cooking disaster. That can happen in chemistry, but with this chapter, we're going to look at the techniques to avoid those kind of processes and really make sure you take care of business in the lab. So let's talk about a chemical equation, all right? And this is an example of a chemical equations here. This is aluminum reacting with oxygen to make aluminum oxide. Now, because aluminum and oxygen are by themselves and they're neutral, they don't have a positive or negative charge, I would call those elemental forms. So that's elemental aluminum and elemental oxygen reacting to make aluminum oxide, Al2O3. So we need to know the terms reactants and products, and we also need to know how much of each of them to add to make a successful reaction. And you can probably imagine that's what those numbers are for in front of those different things. Those numbers in front of the aluminum, the oxygen, and the aluminum oxide are called stoichiometric coefficients. And you don't have to spell that by any means. It would be one of those. Anyway, spelling was always weird for me. Anyway, stoichiometric coefficients are like a relative amount. So you can think of it as 4 parts aluminum reacting with 3 parts oxygen to make 2 parts aluminum oxide. But instead of parts, you can probably imagine that that's going to have something to do with the moles. Hint, hint, spoiler alert. Anyway, there's another thing too about that reaction. They have a little S and a little G and a little S on the aluminum oxide. And those refer to the states of the compounds. You don't always see them, but they are very helpful. So that tells the chemist that you have a solid form of aluminum reacting with a gaseous form of oxygen. And the thing you're going to make, the aluminum oxide, is also a solid. Now, reactants are everything to the left of the arrow. And reactants are what go into the reaction, the ingredients, all right? And then the product or products are the pieces to the right of the arrow. Those are the pieces you're going to get out. So instead of having a recipe where flour, sugar, water, eggs, whatever makes a cake, where the cake was the product, this is the chemical version of a recipe where we're adding aluminum and oxygen to make aluminum oxide. And we know the states of the matter, we know the relative amounts, and we're going to be exploring more about how these stoichiometric coefficients can really help the chemist out. This is a reaction between phosphorus and chlorine to make phosphorus trichloride. Now, phosphorus is what they call a tetramer. It's P4 in its normal state, and you can see it's a solid. And it's reacting with chlorine gas, you can see right there. And on the product side, what you would make then is phosphorus trichloride. And notice that little L right there, that's the liquid state. That's what that means. So because phosphorus is a tetramer, P4, 4, you're going to see that we'd have to add 6 Cl2s. Now, chlorine is one of the diatomic, have no fear of ice, clear, brew. It's the clear in that statement, or Hunkel Brief. That's the chlorine. Anyway, 6 Cl2, making 4 PCl3s. And the numbers and stuff are what we'll kind of deal with in this section. The stoichiometric coefficients, there's a 1 in front of the P4, but chemists don't write the 1. Chemists are lazy, whatever you want to say. If it was 0, you wouldn't put it in the reaction at all. And if there's more than 1, then you definitely put it there. But the 6 and the 4 are stoichiometric coefficients, along with the invisible 1. And it also does list the physical states of the reactants and products. So a solid and a gas end up making a liquid. Kind of cool. Don't forget the 7 diatomics. Here's another reaction. This reaction makes iron 3 chloride, FeCl3, from iron and chlorine. Now again, chlorine, one of the diatomics, have no fear of ice, clear, brew, so it's a diatomic, but iron is not one of those. So notice that iron is listed by itself, Fe. And most elements are by themselves. If they're not the 7 diatomics, they'll be by themselves. Once in a while, I will tell you about something like phosphorus, the P4 we just saw, but that's rare. Okay, most of them, like iron, are by themselves. So in this reaction, the reactants are 2 irons and 3 chlorines. They make 2 iron 3 chlorides, 2 moles of product, as we're going to see. There's a little thing down there. The evidence of a chemical reaction can be observed a lot of times, or felt. Heat change is definitely something you can see in that picture up there. That looks like some pretty good energy coming out, so that's going to be one way. If you make a solid, or if you see a gas come out, or even a color change, a lot of times those kind of things mean that there's been some kind of chemical reaction happen, so you can see that something's going on. This reaction is really powerful. This is an example of an aluminum oxide, as we talked about earlier, coming from aluminum and oxygen gas. And notice there on the right, that's a lot of energy. You can really see it. So in the reaction like that, where you have 4 Al and 3 O2 making 2 Al2O3, there's actually a couple different ways to interpret that. One way is on a molecular level, where you can think about atoms and molecules. So if you think about it as 4 aluminum atoms, that's going to react with 3 oxygen or O2 molecules, and those combined will give 2 molecules of aluminum oxide. And that's kind of the way that chemists think about it on an atomic or molecular scale. But what we're going to do most of the time is the second one, and I kind of babbled about it earlier because it's so common in my world, and that it's those are also mole ratios. So you can also think about it as 4 moles of aluminum reacting with 3 moles of O2 to make 2 moles of Al2O3. And chemists, and you now too, can think about it as either way, on the atomic level, individual atoms and molecules reacting, or you can think about it as the moles way. In the moles way, we have control as a chemist when you're in the laboratory, because you can measure out grams and stuff like that.
Mercury 2 oxide breaks down or decomposes readily when heated. If we were to weigh the compound before heating and compare its mass to that of the mercury remaining after the reaction, it would seem that decomposition causes a change in the system's mass. The product mercury would weigh less than the reactant. In reality, the decomposition liberates the reactant's oxygen atoms as gaseous dioxygen O2. All matter present before the reaction still exists after it. The reaction obeys the law of conservation of matter.
In the old days, people would measure so much mercury 2 oxide, which the formula HGO, they'd weigh it before they heated it up, and then they'd heat it up like the little video shows right there, and the mass of what was left was less than the mass that they started with. And that's why people didn't really understand how this was all working out. But now what we do is we realize that all the matter that goes into a reaction has to be accounted for on the way back out. So in that example, with the mercury 2 oxide being heated, the O2 oxygen is liberated. That's those little red, double red dots there going away. And the mercury, kind of the silvery thing, is what's left. So no mass was lost in the reaction, but we did transform it. And that's usually what chemistry is all about. So the same numbers of atoms are present in a reaction at both the beginning and the end, all right? The amount of the matter in the system does not change, all right? I like to think about this as you have to put on your accounting hat. You have to take into account the matter that was there at the beginning and the matter that was there at the end. They will rearrange on you, but you won't gain or lose any, and that's important. The fancy way to state this is through what's called the law of conservation of matter, and that just says that matter cannot be created or destroyed. All the matter that goes in equals all the matter that goes out. Informally, it's also known as the law of mass action, and both terms mean the same thing, all right? So again, all those both say is that you have to account for all the matter. You can't lose matter, you can't make more matter and stuff like that, and that's going to lead us to what's important in this chapter, which is being able to balance a chemical equation. Balancing chemical equations or chemical reactions is just the way that chemists know that all the matter is taken care of. We know where the matter went to, we know where it's coming from. Very important in chemistry. Lavoisier was the one who proposed this idea where matter has to be conserved. And conserved here just means you're not creating or destroying anything. And Lavoisier was a really cool chemist. He was politically on the wrong side of some things. So anyway, I'll let you read up on that later if you're interested. But Lavoisier was cool. He was a French chemist and stuff. And again, note the date, 1788. Pretty crazy. So anyway, Lavoisier basically just said that, yeah, matter that goes in must be accounted for on the way back out. You can't create matter or destroy matter.
When pieces of aluminum foil are placed in a beaker containing bromine, a violent reaction occurs. The elements react to produce aluminum bromide, which consists of two aluminum atoms for every six bromine atoms. It is visible as a white powder deposited on the beaker.
So in this reaction, you are making aluminum bromide. Now, aluminum bromide, all right, is really AlBr3. That's what we would have done before. But because aluminum is in group 3A, one of my twisted metals, a lot of times aluminum likes to make what I call a dimer, which is basically one aluminum bromide and a second aluminum bromide coming together. And that's what we have right here. The Al2Br6 is an example of two AlBr3s coming together. And this is a function of this twisted metal process. And we're going to talk more about why group 3A is so twisted. That sounds kind of funky. Anyway, and please realize that twisted metals is just my informal way of talking about that group. But anyway, this is an example of how this works out. But anyway, neither here nor there. So let's say we want to make this Al2Br6 dimeric aluminum bromide blah, blah, blah compound. All right, cool. Well, we could just throw random amounts of aluminum and bromine in and make, hopefully, the Al2Br6. But if you put your thinking helmet on, all right, we can do a better job. The formula for this thing is Al2Br6. So if we're going to make one aluminum bromide dimer, one Al2Br6, we're going to need two aluminums, and we're going to need a total of six bromine atoms. And if you look on the bottom down there, we've got some aluminum atoms. Those are those kind of gold atoms right there. And then there's also over here some Br2s. And on the right-hand side, here's this big Al2Br6. And if you see there on both the right and the left side, there's two gold aluminum atoms. And there's also a total of six bromine atoms. On the left reactant side, there is bromine Br2. On the right side, they're all connected to the Al2Br6. But the important part here is not the form it takes, it's just that the atoms going in are equal to the atoms going out. And that's what we've got. Two gold on the left, two gold aluminum on the right, and a total of six bromine atoms on the left, three Br2s, and a total of six bromine atoms on the right in that Al2Br6. So to write this as a balanced equation, what we would do is we would write a 2 in front of the Al, we'd write a 3 in front of the Br2, and we would have the invisible 1 in front of the Al2Br6. that would be the way that we would get across two gold aluminum atoms, three Br2s, or six bromine atoms total to make that Al2Br6. So this is an example of how you balance an equation, all right? You want to make sure that the atoms are the same on the left and the right. And one thing that I do sometimes when I get stuck, I literally write a line down the middle between the reactants and products. And you can see how you have two aluminums on the left and you have two gold aluminums on the right, and you have a total of six bromine atoms on the left and you have a total of six bromine atoms on the right. And if both sides are equal, that means you have a balanced reaction. And honestly, this kind of way of balancing on both sides is totally cool. I highly recommend it if you ever get stuck on these.
In the combustion of propane, a single propane molecule reacts with five molecules of O2 to produce three molecules of carbon dioxide and four molecules of water.
Propane is used in a lot of home barbecue systems. So if you've ever had a propane barbecue and stuff going, then you're good to go. Propane is a compound with carbon and hydrogen. And we're going to see in the next section that propane, like a lot of the organic things, reacts with O2 oxygen to make CO2, which is what we have on the left side, and water, H2O, on the right side. Oxygen is the red atom. So notice on the CO2, the oxygens are on the left and the right, and the blackish carbon is in the middle. So that's CO2. On the right, water, oxygen is in the middle, and the hydrogens are one kind of to the left, lower left, and one kind of to the lower right. We'll talk about why those look that way in Chem 222. But for right now, let's imagine that we wish to balance this reaction. Now, propane is C3H8. Oxygen is O2. CO2, carbon dioxide, and water are the products. So the question is, how many of each do you do? And what I would do here is I would start by balancing the carbon and hydrogen first, because all of the carbon in C3H8 ends up as carbon and CO2, just like all the hydrogen in propane ends up as water. And I'm going to leave oxygen for last, because if I change the number in front of oxygen, it will only affect the O. You're going to have oxygen from two sources, CO2 and water from there. So let's go ahead and try this. C3H8, the 3 of carbon. Let's put a 3 right there. That would give 3 carbons on the product side, just like we have 3 carbons on the reactant side. And 8 hydrogens in propane. Now, water comes as H2O, so 2 hydrogens for that. So let's tentatively put a 4 right there. If you do that, now the carbons and hydrogens are good, but the oxygens aren't right. And if you're ever uncertain, go ahead and do the balance thing. Here's carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. So right now we have 3 carbons from propane, and we have 3 carbons from CO2. We have 8 hydrogens from the C3H8, and we have 4 times 2, 8 hydrogens from the water. Now, oxygen, though, is tricky because you can see it's in both CO2 and water. So on the product side, 3 times 2 oxygens for CO2 means 6 O's. But I also have 4 times 1. We also have 4 oxygens from the water. So that means we have a total of 10 oxygens on the product side. And the reactant side, O2, we have to have them in 2. So tentatively, let's put a 5 right there. Because if we put a 5, then 5 times 2 is 10. So knowing that, I would have an invisible 1 by the C3H8, a 5 by the O2, and that would make 3 CO2 and 4 water. And I think that one is good to go. So let's check it now. Bam, 5O2 makes 3 CO2 plus 4 waters. But again, notice there how I balanced it. I made like a little chart. You can make it in the middle of the reactant product arrow, or you can do it on the side, whatever works. This is a good way to check yourself if you're ever stuck. This is another example of a compound that reacts like the C3H8. This particular one is called diboring. You don't need to worry about that. But anyway, B4H10 also reacts with O2. It makes B2O3 and water. So again, what I'm going to do on this one, let's make a little chart. And I'm going to have boron, I'm going to have hydrogen, and I'm going to have oxygen. Those are the atoms on both the left and the right. And right now, we have four borons, all right, atoms in the B4H10. So that means at the very least, I'm going to have to put a 2 right there, because 2 times the B2 would give me 4 borons, and they would be balanced. So tentatively, let's put that there. But we also have 10 hydrogens, all right, from the B4H10. So let's put a 10 right there. Now, on the water side, you can see that hydrogen, once again, comes in pairs of 2. So let's put a 5 right there, and that would make everything balanced for hydrogen. And like before, we'll do oxygen last. So oxygen comes in 2s, and you can see you have 2 times 3, or 6 oxygens from the B2O3. Plus 5 times 1, 5 oxygens in the water. And maybe you can see this is going to be a little bit of a problem, because we want 11 oxygen atoms, but on the reactant side, oxygen comes in 2s, all right? So you can't really have 11 oxygen atoms if they come in pairs of 2. What we would like to do is put 11 halves right there, because 11 halves times 2 would give us the 11 atoms we need. So if we could put 11 halves right there, this would be balanced, because it's 11 halves times 2. The 2s would cancel out. We have 11 atoms on both sides. Oh, cool for school. And we'd have 1 B4H10 plus 11 halves O2. Going to 2 B2O3s and 5 waters. But chemists really hate fractions, all right? If you don't have to have a fraction in chemistry, you should try and avoid it. It's just kind of the unwritten rule of chemistry. So we can't leave this as 11 halves, all right? That's just like bad news when it comes to chemistry. But don't despair, because it's easy to get rid of something over 2. You just multiply by 2. If you do that, though, if you multiply by 2, you've got to multiply everything through by 2. So instead of 1, 11 halves, 2, and 5, we're going to multiply all those numbers by 2. You're going to have 2 B4H10, and if you multiply this by 2, it becomes 11O2. We would then have 4 B2O3s, and we would have 10 waters. So let's make a prediction here. 2, 11 on the reactant side, and 4 and 10 on the product side. And if you do this, bam, 2 B4H10 plus 11O2 makes 4 B2O3 plus 10 H2O. So you can see the kind of process that's used to balance an equation. The diagram below shows the reaction of phosphorus and chlorine to make phosphorus trichloride, and it says which one is correct. Now, remember here and stuff that phosphorus comes as a tetramer, all right? It's not just one phosphorus atom, it's a whole bunch. So if you look at these, the reaction involves one phosphorus atom and 6 chlorine atoms to produce one phosphorus trichloride molecule. That's not right. Down here in the very picture, you can see there's 4 phosphorus, 4 gray P's, and we do have 6 Cl2s, so that part would be right. Actually, it's not right. 6 Cl atoms, it's 6 Cl2s. It's not 6 Cl, so that's not right at all. That whole thing is bogus. Just drop that one like a hot potato. Next one. Reaction involves 4 phosphorus atoms. All right, that's right. It says P4, but it is 4 phosphorus, and 12 chlorine atoms, so six chlorine Cl2s times 2 would be 12 to produce 4 PCl3 molecules. Hey, I'm kind of liking the sound of that one. So, yep, that one is correct. That would be the best answer. And again, it's because, as you can see there, phosphorus isn't an individual. It's one of those weird tetramers. It makes then 4 PCl3s. The last one, again, doesn't have the one P atom, so that one's kind of messed up as well. So when you're balancing equations, here's some hints and stuff to help you around. First of all, balance the atoms which occur in only one compound on each side last. And that's an example of the oxygen we saw. O2 was by itself and stuff, so that's why that was the last one to do. Do the more complicated, if you will, combinations first and do that last. Balance the remaining atoms first and stuff, totally. You want to reduce the coefficients to the smallest whole numbers. And this is important. Let's say that you had something like, it would be 4 Na and 2 Cl2s making 4 NaCl. Let me write that out. We could have 4 Na and 2 Cl2s making 4 NaCl. And technically, this would be balanced, all right? The atoms on the left equal the atoms on the right, 4 Na's on both sides, 2 times 2, 4 chlorines on the left and 4 chlorines on the right. However, reducing coefficients just means make them all the smallest whole numbers possible. So as an example of that, 4, 2, and 4, we can definitely divide all of those coefficients by 2. And we'd have a 2 right there. 2 divided by 2 would be 1, invisible, and this one would reduce to 2. So you want to make the coefficients as smallest whole numbers as possible. And that's really important. Most of the time, it's not a big deal, but once in a while, it does happen. Try and make it bad. Now, if you ever have a new reaction and you're not certain if it's balanced, check yourself. Do that kind of analysis where you look at the atoms on both the reactant and the product side, and if the answers, the atoms add up to both sides, you're good to go. You can always do that, and I do that myself sometimes. And finally, all of the charges will be balanced in a chemical reaction as well. And this is something that we'll talk about in a future lecture. If you look at the sodium and chlorine making sodium chloride, all of those are neutral. They don't have a charge. And if you had like an Na plus on the left and nothing with a charge on the right, that would be an unbalanced reaction. So it's really mass, the atom, and the charges, which are balanced. And we'll focus more on the charges in a later lecture. But if you have that and stuff, it will make you stronger overall, which is cool. So stoichiometry is a study of quantitative aspects of chemical reactions. Quantitative means quantity, which means you're going to be measuring out different reactants to make the right combinations. So stoichiometry is just the science, if you will, of the study, like how much to add, how much you're going to get out. And stoichiometry literally has its laurels, if you will, on the principles of that conservation of matter or law of mass action. You have to know what goes in, you have to know it comes out, and everything has to be balanced. If you have a reaction like this one, for the 4 aluminums and 3 oxygens make 2 aluminum oxide, you have actually different ratios that you can use to make this kind of stoichiometry stuff possible. Now, remembering that that reaction means 4 moles of aluminum and 3 moles of oxygen make 2 moles of aluminum oxide, you can get all kinds of different ratios. And for this particular reaction, there are 6 different ratios. So you have, for example, a 4 mole aluminum to 3 mole oxygen relationship, which is what that first one is right there that I put a star next to. So if you were starting with moles of oxygen, you could figure out how many moles of aluminum were needed using this particular ratio right here. Again, you want to cancel what you start with, moles of oxygen, to get what you're looking for, moles of aluminum, that's what you need. On the other hand, if you have so many moles of aluminum and you want to know how many moles of oxygen you need, then you'd use the lower one, this one right here, because now moles of aluminum are on the bottom, moles of oxygen are on the top. So you can let these play any way you want. If you start with moles of aluminum, then and you want to find moles of oxygen, use this one right here. On the other hand, if you have moles of aluminum and you're curious how much product Al2O3 you can make, then you'd want to use this one right here. All right, because moles of aluminum on the bottom, moles of aluminum oxide on the top. And so all of these can be really helpful, and you can pick and play which one works for what you're doing. These are nothing more than relationships based on the balanced reaction. The 4 is the only number you see in front of the aluminum, for example, and the 3 is the only number you see in front of the oxygen. All right, so you just keep going by using what you're wanting, and you can do all kinds of neat things. This is how chemists figure out like the quantities that are needed to make certain products, and also how much product is going to be made. Just like in cooking, if you have, you know, so many cups of flour, you can figure out how many cookies you're going to make. Well, if we have so many moles of aluminum, we can figure out how many moles of aluminum oxide we're going to make, etc., etc. Ammonia is prepared by the reaction nitrogen plus 3 hydrogen makes 2 ammonium. And let's say that we have 10 moles of hydrogen with an excess of nitrogen, which just means we have more nitrogen than we know what to do with. Which stoichiometric factor would we use to find the moles of ammonium? So again, the key part here is that we're starting with moles of hydrogen. And like we talked about earlier, the thing you start with is going to go on the bottom, all right? And what you're looking for is going to be the part that goes on top, and that's going to be moles of ammonia. Now there's a 2 in front of the ammonia, so it's going to be 2 moles NH3 on top, and we're starting with hydrogen. Hydrogen has a 3 in front of it, 3 moles H2 on the bottom, 2/3, it's going to be answer D. All right. Now remember, a balanced reaction always shows the correct mole ratio. So it's always going to have a 2 by the moles of NH3 and a 3 by the moles of H2. And because we're starting with H2, we want the moles of H2 to cancel. So H2 is going to be on the bottom. NH3, what we're looking for, is going to be on the top. You would take that 10 moles and essentially multiply by 2/3 to turn moles of hydrogen that you're starting with into moles of ammonia you're going to get out. And this is, again, where chemists get paid, because some people really do need ammonia. This is one way to figure out how much you would make. Here's an example, again, of how the chemists get paid, if you will. And this reaction involves a compound called ammonium nitrate. Ammonium is NH4+. If you take ammonia, NH3, and add an H+ to it, it makes ammonium. Nitrate, NO3-. So they're both polyatomic ions, but they're both positive, negative 1, so they come together 1-1. Anyway, let's say we have a pound, which is nothing you need to know, but it's 454 grams. There's about 454 grams in a pound. So we've got 454 grams of this ammonium nitrate that decomposes. It breaks down. And the question is, how much dinitrogen monoxide, N2O, and water are formed? And then it also says, what's the theoretical yield of products? Okay, to answer a question like this, we need, of course, something so important for this chapter, and you probably guessed it. Yeah, the balanced reaction. And it appears that the balanced reaction is going to have ammonium nitrate as the reactant and N2O and water as products. So let's figure out what the relationship is going to be. And you can see how ammonium nitrate has 2 nitrogens in it, just like N2O has 2 nitrogens in it. However, there is a lot of hydrogen, 4 hydrogens in the ammonium, so we're going to need 2 waters. So in this balanced reaction, we would have 1 ammonium nitrate as a reactant, and that would break down into N2O and 2 waters as products. And all of the atoms are balanced. I encourage you to double check me if you don't believe me, and that's totally fine. I completely understand. We are good to go. But anyway, the first step in a lot of these reactions, find the balanced chemical reaction. So now, if we want to turn, if we want to figure out the yields or whatever of the N2O and water, which are the products, by the way, we're going to have to use that mole ratio. And so the 454 grams of ammonium nitrate, we can't leave it as that. We've got to turn it into moles. Now, ammonium nitrate, if you figure out the molar mass, is 80.04. So again, to get that number, I took two nitrogens, and each nitrogen on the periodic table is about 14 grams per mole. I also added four hydrogens. Hydrogen's about 1 gram per mole, so that's 4 times 1. And I added that to three oxygens. Oxygen's about 16 grams per mole in the periodic table, so 16 times 3. So 2 times 14 plus 4 times 1 plus 3 times 16 is about 80. And to better sig figs, and I'm doing verbally right now, 80.04 is what you get to the hundredth. And that number is the grams per mole, the molar mass of ammonium nitrate. So if we want to turn grams of ammonium nitrate into moles, we're going to divide 454 by 80.04. And you can see that the grams will cancel out. We'll have moles, 3 sig figs in 454. So the answer to 3 sig figs, 5.68 moles ammonium nitrate. So 454 grams ammonium nitrate represents 5.68 moles of ammonium nitrate. Next step. Now that we have the moles of reactant, let's convert the moles of the reactant into moles of the product. And this is where the balanced chemical reaction kicks in. And again, we can use any ratio we want to based on this reaction. So we could use 1 mole of NH4NaO3 to 1 mole N2O because they both have ones in front of them. We could also use the relationship of 1 NH4NO3 to 2 moles of water because of the 1 to 2. And really, you can do N2O first, or you can do water first. It doesn't matter. I think in this example, I did water first, all right? And you don't have to, but it's totally fine. And if you're going to do water, you need a stoichiometric factor, which is just the ratio of moles in the reaction. So for this one, because we're starting with ammonium nitrate, we want ammonium nitrate on the bottom and water on the top. So there's a 1 in front of the NH4NO3 and a 2 in front of the water. We're going to use a factor of 2 to 1. And that says that 2 moles of water are created or produced for every 1 mole of ammonium nitrate that's used up. This, my friends, is the power of the balanced chemical reaction. To get that 2 to 1 ratio is really important. If you didn't have that 2 to 1 ratio, everything would come up kind of messy. You wouldn't have the right answer and you'd end up with weird things. So knowing this relationship, this stoichiometric factor, super important. Now, once you have the factor, then you can just take that 5.68 moles and multiply it. Because remember, it's 5.68 moles ammonium nitrate. You can see how the moles of ammonium nitrate cancel, and you'll have then just moles of water. So 5.68 times 2 to 3 significant figures, 11.4 moles of water are produced. Now, this is kind of cool for a chemist, because here you've got 454 grams of ammonium nitrate just staring at you, and it's like, what are you going to do? Well, you can actually calculate how much moles, anyway, of water are going to come out using these steps. The grams to moles is what we've done so far. The grams to moles use the molar mass of ammonium nitrate, and then the moles to moles is just the relationship from the balanced reaction. If you're going to do moles of N2O, the other product, all right, notice how N2O and NH4NO3 are both relationships of 1 to 1. Like, it's 1 mole ammonium nitrate makes 1 mole of N2O. So if you had 5.68 moles ammonium nitrate, you will make 5.68 moles of N2O. The ratio is different. That's why the you have a different answer than you did for water. You're going to end up with twice as many moles of water as you do the N2O. We talked earlier about moles, but honestly, most people like to know things in mass, which is grams or pounds or kilograms. I joke because I don't really like the English units, but anyway, that's fine. They want to know kilograms and grams and pounds and stuff like that. Tons, all right. Anyway, I digress. Now, the number we're going to calculate here has a fancy name, and it's called theoretical yield, and it's how much of the product should be created. Notice I'm emphasizing there this should. We'll talk about that later. So the theoretical yield of these things is just how much should be created. So for water, if you wanted to know the theoretical yield of water, 11.4 moles of water times the molar mass. And again, for 18.02, that came from one oxygen and two hydrogen, or 1 times 16 plus 2 times hydrogen is about 18 grams per mole. You should be making 204 grams of water. So theoretically, in this reaction, if you put 454 grams of ammonium nitrate in and it all reacts, you will be making 204 grams of water. That's the theoretical yield of water in this reaction. This is what I call the grams, moles, moles, grams dance. And we're going to do this a lot in chemistry. Grams to moles to moles to grams. So grams to moles, we took the original grams, turned them into moles of ammonium nitrate. Then the moles to moles part is where the balanced chemical reaction comes in. For water, it was 2 moles of water for every 1 mole ammonium nitrate. And then finally, moles to grams, we're turning it back from moles into grams. So in this case, water's molar mass, 18.02 grams per mole. That's how we got the 204. You can't really go straight from grams to grams. You have to do the grams to moles to grams at least once to see what's happening. Now, there is another product, though, N2O. And if you're curious how much N2O is formed, you can totally do the grams to moles to moles to grams. Now, we saw earlier that you had, I think it was 5.68 moles of N2O because of the 1-to-1 ratio ammonium nitrate. And from there, you could find the molar mass of N2O, and you could multiply the moles by the molar mass to get the grams, and that would be fine. However, law of mass action has a little trick that sometimes is used. Now, if we put 454 grams of ammonium nitrate and matter cannot be created or destroyed, that means that on the product side, we're going to have a total of 454 grams. And we already calculated that there's 204 grams of water created. So notice that 204 is a lot less than 454. Where did all the rest of the mass go, Dr. Russell? Oh, thank you, Everest, in the back of the room. Yeah, the other mass is N2O. So all you have to do really on this problem is take the total mass you started with, 454, subtract the grams of water, which you calculated, 204, and you should be able to figure out that the N2O that's created, 250 grams. And notice the dot by the zero. That means that's a significant number. That's a 3 sig fig number. Now, you don't have to do it this way. You could also take the moles of N2O and turn it into grams, and that would be fine too, but I am trying to teach you all my lazy chemist techniques. Here's the opposite way. N2O is about 44.01 grams per mole, all right? And if you do that, then that comes out to be 5.68 moles times 44.01, 250 grams. Nitrogen's about 14 grams per mole, and there's two of them, so that's 28. 28 plus 16, 28, 38 would be 44 grams per mole, and to better sig figs, that's what you got. So you have more than one way to do this kind of problem. Now, the latter way, the way that's done at the bottom, will always work. The top way, law of mass action, you have to be careful. There's some tricks we're going to talk about. So if in doubt, I do encourage you to do grams to moles to grams, which would be like this part right here. On the other hand, law of mass action is a lot easier if you can get it to work, and we'll talk about when it works and when it doesn't work in a bit. This is something that sometimes people like. It's a diagram. Now, remembering that all the mass has to be accounted for, all right? In this reaction, ammonium nitrate makes N2O and H2O. So we started with 454 grams, which we then figured out was 5.68 moles. And in this reaction, all of the ammonium nitrate is reacted. So the change, how much it goes up or down, minus 5.68. And there's nothing left at the end, all right? right? But the matter has to go somewhere. So the 5.68 moles of ammonium nitrate made a 1-to-1 or 5.68 moles of N2O, and 2 times that number, 2 times 5.68 moles of water. So at the end of this reaction, 5.68 moles N2O and 11.4 moles of water, and multiplying both of those numbers by their molar masses, 250 grams of N2O, 204 grams of water. And you add those numbers up, sure enough, it equals the mass you started with. Mass is conserved. So if these two numbers and the number I circled earlier are equal, you are good to go and you are following law of mass action. Woohoo! We calculated the theoretical yield earlier of water and of N2O. And by hook or crook, by a crook, we figured out that N2O, that theoretical yield, how much we should have gotten out, 250 grams. And remember, it's 250 dots, so that's 3 sig figs. What happens a lot, though, in chemistry is that even though you should have made 250 grams, you only made, in this case, 131 grams. Now, N2O is a gas, and it's easy to have a leak in the valve or something like that, and some of the N2O goes away. It's also possible that the N2O was reacting with something else. There was like some kind of weird secondary reaction. There's lots of reasons why the actual yield, which is how much we actually got out, is not the same as the theoretical yield. And if you've ever been like cooking and maybe making cookies or something like that, maybe you, oh man, accidentally dropped cookie dough on the ground and the dog ate it. All right. That would be a real life example of when a regular recipe went bad. In my case, it would probably be because I was eating the cookie dough, which I do like a lot, I confess. So I didn't make as many cookies as I wanted. So there's lots of silly reasons and also very good science reasons why the actual yield, how much you actually ended up with, was less than what you should have ended up with. So in this not as exciting as cookie example, we should have had 250 grams of N2O. We only ended up with 131. So percent yield is something that chemists use a lot to figure out how effective your method of making N2O is, all right? And the percent yield just compares the actual yield to the theoretical yield. And it's a percentage, so it's usually less than 100%, stuff like that. Percent yield is equal to actual yield divided by theoretical yield times 100%. So in this example, we should have had 250 grams. And for whatever reason, scientific or otherwise, we only ended up with 131 grams. So the percent yield, actual divided by theoretical times 100, 131 divided by 250 times 100%, this reaction had a 52.4% yield of the dinitrogen monoxide, the N2O. That could be really good. It could be really bad. We don't know enough about the reaction to make those kind of designations. But we can at least say that, hey, in this reaction, we had a little bit more than 50% yield of our N2O. Now, if the lab across the street has a way to make like 75% yield consistently, that might be like a better process to make the N2O. This is how percent yields can be used. And again, don't think of percent yields as like 90% or higher is an A and 80% to 89 is a B, that kind of stuff. One time in graduate school, I had a percent yield on a transformation of a chromium compound from kind of a blue to kind of a purple. And I was so excited, I like called my parents and it was like 4 a.m. And they were like, oh man, you need to get back to sleep, which was probably true, let's be honest. But anyway, I was so excited and my percent yield for that transformation was like 5%. It was so low, okay? But it was exciting because I was the first person who had ever done it, all right? And that was pretty cool. And the first time you do something, it's always harder than the subsequent times, at least usually. So yeah, that was a really low yield. No one gave me an F because that was the first time it had been done, and that was pretty cool. So don't think about these as A, B, C, D, F kind of ratios. 52.4% could be outstanding or it could be horrible. We just don't know. We have to know more about the chemistry to make those kind of calls. This is a reaction. It should have created 74.0 grams, but for whatever reason, we only ended up with 29.1 grams of product. And the question is, calculate the percent yield. So again, it's actual divided by theoretical. We actually only ended up with 29.1 grams. We should have ended up with 74 grams. So in your calculator, 29.1 divided by 74.0, it comes out to be answer E, 39.3%. That would be the percent yield for this reaction. Once in a while, percent yields are greater than 100%. Those mean usually that the product is contaminated. A lot of times if you have a wet sample, like with water, the water adds on and that will add mass. You should never have a negative percent yield. So if you get a negative, something's wrong. But and most of the time, percent yields will be less than 100%. This is a fancy way to designate the grams, moles, moles, grams thing I talked about earlier. Now, grams is just mass, all right, number of grams. And if you use the molar mass, you can get to moles. And stoichiometric factor, that's the part that comes from the balanced reaction, will allow you to go from A to B, what you started with A to what you're going to B. And then finally, what we'll do most of the time is use molar mass to get back to grams of B. So we went from, for example, grams of ammonium nitrate to moles of ammonium nitrate using the molar mass. We used a 1:2 ratio to go from moles of ammonium nitrate to moles of water. And finally, we used the molar mass of water to turn it into grams of water or mass of water. So that's what we did earlier. But there is more you can do than just the grams, moles, moles, grams dance. If you know the density of the material, you can actually start with volume, all right? Because volume times density will give you the mass. And if you knew the mass, you could go moles and moles to mass and stuff like that. And on the other side, you can see it's the opposite. If you wanted to turn it into milliliters of something and you knew the density, you could do that. You could divide, I think, by density. But there's even more than that. You can also go from number of particles, molecules, atoms, ions, whatever, to moles using Avogadro's number. And from there, you can go molecules, moles to moles to grams or something like that if you want to. You could also go molecules to moles to moles to molecules. Again, this is using Avogadro's number, 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd. And in the next chapter, I'm not going to talk about it right now, there's something called molarity. And molarity is the moles of what you're excited by per volume per liter. And so if you know the volume, you can use molarity to go moles, and the other side you can go moles back to volume. We'll talk about that in the next section, but this is pretty cool. This shows the different types of transformations that are possible in chemistry. Most of the time, grams to moles to moles to grams will be great, but we'll do some of these others too. Just one more hat in our cap, if you will. One more thing we can do.
Hydrogen peroxide in water decomposes slowly at room temperature. In the presence of manganese dioxide, however, the decomposition occurs much more rapidly. The reaction produces gaseous oxygen and water. The hydrogen peroxide is oxidized and reduced at the same time. It undergoes a disproportionation reaction. The manganese dioxide serves only as a catalyst and is not consumed in the reaction.
First of all, this video kind of bums me out because it's manganese 4 oxide. Manganese is a transition metal, a variable charge metal, and you don't use dyes and tries unless you're with nonmetals. Manganese is certainly a metal. So I'm kind of bummed at this video that they called it manganese dioxide. You call it manganese 4 oxide. We're going to be good chemists. But anyway, I digress. If you've ever bought hydrogen peroxide in the store, it comes in a brown bottle and you're supposed to keep it in the refrigerator. Hydrogen peroxide, which is H2O2, breaks down into water and oxygen pretty readily. And if you want to see it happen a little faster, manganese 4 oxide is what they call a catalyst. It just makes the reaction go faster without being used up. So at the end of this reaction, if we got rid of the water, we boiled it away or whatever, we could reuse the MnO2 in a future thing. We'll talk about catalysts more in Chem 222. But for right now, let's say that we have exactly 5.00 grams of H2O2, hydrogen peroxide. And the question is how much O2 and how much water can be obtained? And again, we have the balanced reaction there. So we just need to use grams to moles to moles to grams, where we'd start with grams of H2O2 and turn it into moles H2O2. And then we'd use moles H2O2 to go to moles of water, say, and moles of water to grams of water. And we do the same thing going from moles of H2O2 to moles of O2 and then to grams of O2 doing that. In this particular reaction, first, again, like I said, take 5.00 grams H2O2 and turn it into moles of H2O2. And to do that, you would use the molar mass, H2O2, 2 times hydrogen plus 2 times oxygen, roughly 2 times 1 plus 2 times 16. That would get you to moles. And then you want to use a stoichiometric factor to find either moles of oxygen or moles of water. If you're going to do oxygen first, then you'd use 2 moles H2O2 per 1 mole O2. So it would be like 1 mole O2 on the top, 2 moles H2O2 on the bottom, and you'd multiply that times the moles of H2O2 from step 1. That's how you did the moles to moles part of the grams, moles, moles, grams thing. And then finally, once you have the oxygen, you can turn it into grams. And if you multiply moles of O2 by the molar mass of O2, which is about 32 grams per mole, you should get the answer 2.35 grams. Now, you could do the same thing for water. You'd go back to the moles of H2O2. You'd multiply by 2 over 2 or 1 over 1 to get moles of water, and you multiply it by 18.02 grams per mole to get the mass. You could also, in this case, use the total mass that you started with, 5 grams, subtract the 2.35 grams of O2 that you calculated to get the 2.65. That's the law of mass action trick. Either way, please try this on your own. All right, I want you to be able to get these answers. If you don't get these answers, please reach out to me. I can help you with this stuff. It's not hard. It's just grams to moles to moles to grams, and we're going to do a lot of it. And if you don't have this down, then you'll be kind of stuck. So if you aren't getting 2.35 and 2.65, please email me. I will help you out.